what I'm going to go over a little bit tonight is might be, well, we'll see. It might be a little bit, what's the word, esoteric for some people. But the point that I want to make, in part, is that a lot of the things that LaRouche insists on, particularly at this point in history, are not really esoteric. And they're not strange, they're not things only for, academics or avant-garde or any or strange things. They're not, in other words, let's put it this way, what most people think are practical topics are not all that practical. You really can't act on them if you don't know topics that you largely think are impractical. For example, what's the policy of the United States? What's the history of the presidents of the United States? What do we have in the presidency now? What can be done about it? What's the strategic situation globally that's driving the situation that we face today? Most people don't think that's how you should think about things. They think, well, I got to take care of home, I got to take care of family, the healthcare policy, that I can sort of get. I don't see it as a disaster for the country, but I see it as a disaster for me. And all kinds of things like that. Or even if they want to think about bigger things, they say, well, that's not for me. And I don't mean big just in the sense of global. I mean really bigger. I mean, what's the future of humanity? What's our role, not just on the planet? Not so much that we're going to leave the planet, some people may do that. But what do we have to know about the solar system, the universe, to be able to, as human beings, create a future, not just survive? You know, people survive, like, if you want survival, there are Japanese soldiers that are probably still out there from World War II, and they certainly were out there until the 1980s and 1990s, and presumably they survived. They survived at least until the 80s or 90s. That doesn't mean a whole lot. It doesn't really even mean a lot in terms of their own sense of who they were. So people have to think of larger things. Now, I'm going to reference, and this is what LaRouche has been fighting. I'm not going to go that much into it. He has a paper that will probably be on the, is that on the website now, the one that was out today? Okay, there's one called A New President, which is up today, which has, even though it's not tremendously, it's relatively modest length, but it has a great deal of new, you might say, new directions in it. They are things that he has referred to before, but never quite handled in the way that he does in this paper, and it's very timely. I mean, he begins by talking about the crisis of the United States, the crisis of the presidency. We have probably the worst president in American history. And he was preceded by the second worst president in American history. And that says a lot. If you go from W. Bush, the younger, in 2001, to the present, we have had 14 years of the worst presidents in American history. And that says a lot. That says a mouthful. We've had some bad ones. Harry Truman, Andrew Jackson, Buchanan. We've had people who were agents of a foreign power, or controlled by agents of a foreign power. In the case of Jackson, controlled by Burr and Van Buren, or directly agents of a foreign power in the case of Van Buren or Buchanan. And many of the American presidents who were decent or brilliant were assassinated. I mean, it's a little interesting for a country like ourselves to, let's say, think about how many American presidents have been assassinated, leaving aside theories about what happened, just think of the number. Mm-hmm. And compare that, for example, to Great Britain in the last 250 years. I mean, if you go back far enough, there were a lot of kings that were beheaded, killed, et cetera, et cetera. But it's not, you had a wave of assassinations in Europe at the end of the 19th century, in the beginning of the 20th century. Carnot, Jaurès, and some others. Adler did it. Archduke Ferdinand is the famous case that started, supposedly started World War I. But you don't have, over the last 200 years, the United States stands out somewhat. If you think about Lincoln, Garfield, McKinley, Kennedy, and how many assassination attempts. Reagan was almost killed. I mean, he came very close to dying. Then you look at what they did to Clinton, which was a complete operation against the presidency, which a lot of people bought. And you realize, and then you look at the situation we have today. We have the worst economic crisis. And I'm talking about economy, not money. The worst economic crisis in modern history on a global scale. And one of the things to look at in terms of physical economy, look at the state of California or Texas. We have campaigns in both of those states, one by Keisha Rogers for Senate, and then Mike Stager's announcing for Congress later this week or early the following week. But look at California and Texas. California is in the midst of the biggest drought. People are so funny on weather. I mean, forget it. You know, the biggest on record. Now, you know how far back the records go? 1880. That's a blip in the screen of human history, let alone the history of the planet. So, but what we do know is that we're in an inactive period of the sun, and there are certain patterns in the behavior that lead us to believe that we're probably in the midst of a long-term, serious drought. In an area of the country that is not known for its great supplies of water to begin with. Now, what's being done? You have to recognize, for example, the Bureau of Reclamation, which handles 3 million people and 1 million acres. It's a federal agency. Normally, they supply a certain amount of water to supplement agriculture and some of the small agricultural cities. They don't have any water. They're supplying essentially nothing for agriculture. That's the Central Valley. Then you have the State Water Agency, I forget the name of it, that handles 23 million people. Most of Southern Central California, they're allocating zero. Now, what did Jerry Brown and President Obama have to say about this? Well, Obama, who is a minion of pessimism, cultural degenerate pessimism, what did he say? We can't do anything. In fact, you know, he basically said, we're the cause of the problem. All we can do is reduce our use of water. And how are we the cause of the problem? Because we are the cause of global, you know, climate change, warming, cooling, whatever it is, we're causing it.
Global purpose.
Global whatever. No, it is funny. You have to have a little bit of a sense of humor. Because, you know, when it rains a lot, they say it's global weather change. When it doesn't rain at all, they say it's global climate change. When you have tornadoes, they say it's global climate change. If you have no tornadoes, there's no global climate change. That's due to global climate change. If you have a lot of hurricanes, it's due to global climate change. If you have not too many hurricanes, it's due to global climate change. So, no, one thing we can say, the global climate is changing. Okay? And actually, that's not all that surprising. It's been changing for about 3.5 billion years. As far as I know, the planet's climate has never not changed. One good example I just saw, just to go into the extreme version of this, you know, for a long time, and I don't know if this is, but this gives you an idea. For a long time, the basic theory of human development, paleontology, you know, is that, you know, the first human beings that walked upright, or first hominids, or what they call hominins, that walked upright, were probably walking in the savannas of eastern central Africa. You know, grassy plains, and so on and so forth, and they have a whole theory of the advantages of these things and so forth. Now, you'd be interested to know that they, about 20 years ago, they found an early hominin, Ardipithecus ramidus, Ardipithecus. This is about 4.4 million years ago, okay, in the area of the Afar region of Ethiopia. However, what they have discovered in the course of this is that indeed 4.5 million years ago, this was not a savanna, nor was it a desert. It was a woodland area with a woodland creatures and so on and so forth. So now, you know, they think that the first somewhat bipedal creatures were in a totally different climate than exists there today. And that was a mere 4.4 million years ago. And so you have Obama saying we're the cause, Brown saying we're the cause, because he's saying the same thing, he's just a different version. He's not as bad as Obama, in part because he's not the president. But this is what Obama has to say. You can't do anything this is what he says about everything. His basic argument for healthcare, the Obamacare, is we can't afford to do better than this. This is the best we can do. Be thankful that you're getting insurance, that you might be subsidized. Be thankful that you might see a doctor or not, depending on your disease, but you know, we'll at least have a doctor tell you we can't treat you. As compared to simply not being able to be treated because you don't have money, this way you'll have insurance, we'll pay the insurance companies, and they will be able to tell you we can't treat you. Too expensive. You're too old. Because the first people this hits is going to be, roughly speaking, people in, let's say, you know, the last third of their expected lifespan, roughly. So this is the outlook. The outlook, and the outlook is that human beings really aren't worth that much more. Does the existence of human beings allow us to solve problems? Does it allow us to know more about the universe that we live in? Does it give us greater power to produce human beings with a greater opportunity? Human beings are meant to accommodate themselves to nature. The biggest problem with human beings is they think that they're not animals. Human beings have strange beliefs about human creativity, the human mind, human purpose, a different mission than animals. We have to understand that we are animals. That's the issue that comes up in a great deal of this. We've been deluded about that. And of course, this is what's taught to a large extent. Everything is supposed to work in this direction. The Copernican Revolution showed you that the Earth was not at the center. Let's forget whether it was really Copernicus, but you know, the Copernican Revolution. Then we have further developments of this, you know, instead of the progress of the human species, it's the discovery of the regress. And then we get Darwinian evolution, and we should make it specific. It's Darwinian evolution. It's not any idea of evolutionary development is bad. In fact, the nature of the human species is to evolve itself. But what's Darwin's view, or the view that was developed off of Darwin, is that human beings are just animals. They're just complicated animals, driven by the passions of Adam Smith. And we shouldn't think of ourselves as anything else. And when we do, well, for example, when we try to intervene in the economic policy, that's bad. Because isn't the idea of the free market? It's really not a free market. You're supposed to decide freely what you like and don't like in an immediate sense. But you're not supposed to change economic policy because that's interference in the free market. And you have to realize how bloody insane this is, that people buy this kind of brainwashing just by using the word free. You're not free. For example, you're not free to have a government policy to regulate the banks. You can't separate the banks. That's an interference in the free market. It's a very contradictory, paradoxical world. You have the freedom in the short run to express your immediate desire for certain pleasures and how much you're willing to pay for those pleasures. But you have no right to establish a long-term policy. Infrastructure development, bad. It's government. And so you're supposed to stay out of all these things because you're nothing but an animal. And you can see this all in virtually everything people have now accepted. We have a reduced sense of what it is to be human, and therefore we have a reduced sense of creative capability. You know, take the United States. At one time we wanted to explore the solar system. We don't really want to do that anymore. It's too expensive. We might send, you know, go bump into an asteroid somewhere. If it's cheap.
Dancing with the asteroid.
If it's cheap. They have a plan to go to Mars on the cheap. One of the cheap parts of it, you don't get to come back. It's a one-way ticket. You know, it's one thing to get a one-way ticket to New York. It's another thing to get a one-way ticket to Mars. Okay, but that's one of the later plans, because one of the points is that's the way private enterprise works, you know. Let's have the private people do this. And what's the first thing they want to do? Cut the cost. What's the first way to cut the cost? Well, we'll send you there. We can't get you back, but if you hang on long enough, somebody else might come up there. They might have a round-trip ticket. And this passes for rationality. You know, you could spend a whole evening making fun of this stuff. It probably would be good for people's health. People take this stuff way, way too seriously. Oh, I mean, Obama is a zilch. He has no power. He is barely able to think. There's a certain image of him with this somewhat strange, calm demeanor because he doesn't care about anything. He's the kind of thing that, as somebody said, Zeus took a, shall we say, you know, the kings had when you were at dinner with the king, a real king or a queen that ruled, you know, you weren't supposed to leave the table. So, the king would have a chamber pot, and he would do his business into the chamber pot. And you had to sit there through the whole thing. Okay, and all kinds of things like that. Now, there's a rumor that what happened was the Queen of England did her thing, and then said, okay, that's Obama. I'll make him the President of the United States.
And she did.
and then the American population, once they elected him, they said, well, we elected him. We're stuck with him. Ugh, you know. And this is what, you know, these people are ridiculous. Now we have an actual, serious, real crisis. And again, you have to watch what's being fed to the American population. I'm not going to go, people may know a bit about it. But you have this, basically what you have is a drive for war. And this includes thermonuclear war. Now, one of the things that people seem to have forgotten, even people my age, is the idea of, first of all, that thermonuclear war can happen, and secondly, what it would mean. Now, there was a time when maybe it wasn't the worst thing. We grew up a little bit scared. You know, when I was 15 years old, you did have somewhat in your mind, damn, you know, one of the things that could get in the way of my fantasies is a nuclear war. It made you think twice about the girl next door. Because it was people knew this was a possibility, and they knew what the damage was. And so, in fact, at the time, it may have been slightly exaggerated. Because we didn't have, in 1960, the murderous kill capability that was developed in the next 30 or 40 years, if you compare today, in terms of the kill capacity on the globe, and in particular between the United States and Russia even today, while it may be somewhat less than the 80s, it's frankly a multiple of what it was in the 1950s and 60s. Did we ever come to the verge of war? Yes, more than once. Certainly people remember the Cuban Missile Crisis. We've had other situations similarly. That's probably the most dramatic. When people were scared stiff. You know, somebody once said, I don't know if it's 100% true, but one of the great moments when we had the most number of people in churches, synagogues, and mosques in the United States was the Sunday in the middle of the Cuban Missile Crisis. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. But people, now here we are, where we have a situation which would, under any sane circumstances, be considered a threat of thermonuclear war. But what do we have? We have an upheaval in Ukraine, which has been promoted, fostered, organized, financed by the Anglo-American, the transatlantic forces, largely the British Empire. What have they done? They've unleashed a fascist network in Ukraine, and they've called it a protest movement. And everybody knows that this is true. That it's among the hegemonic forces in the protest movement in Kiev are self-avowed fascists. They're the descendants of the organization of Ukrainian nationalism under Stepan Bandera and Lebed. They were exported out afterwards by Alan Dulles and the MI6. And used as a fascist network inside of Eastern Europe and so on and so forth. This is who's doing it. These people say that their enemy is the Russians, the Jews, the Poles, and they say it publicly. These are fascists. And they've been created over many decades, including going into World War II, by the British Empire. The British Empire, exercised a great deal of political and psychological control in the Caucasus through the 19th century, mm-hmm. and used this as a launching point for actions against Russia at that time, which was, a czarist regime and so forth. But what is it that the British have always been worried about? They fear the possibility of an industrialization, an economic development on a large scale in the former colonial world and across Eurasia. And in the late 19th century, in the wake of Lincoln's victory in the Civil War and the expansion of the American system economy, the British determined to do a couple of things. They knew the Civil War taught them one thing. They were not going to defeat or break up the United States militarily. So their next objective, first of all, was a global objective. to consolidate their empire, and they knew at the end of the 19th and the early 20th century that they had to move into a different form than the classic 18th, 19th century imperial companies. They went through economic crises in the early 20th century, and they began to consolidate a different form, a financial form of empire, and the use of the United States as a pawn, as a cat's paw, as a marcher, or as Churchill once famously said, the brawn. He wouldn't say the brown because, you know, that he didn't like brown, but he did like brawn. Anyway, the so what you have in the 20th century was efforts to break up in the late 19th, World War I, efforts to break up any developmental perspective and to capture the United States. It worked to a degree in World War I, though it took a while. Bill Wilson was an Anglophile and a Confederate, a great booster of the Confederacy. But he couldn't get us into the war right away. It took a long time because there was a lot of anti-British sentiment in the United States. And in World War II, you had Franklin Roosevelt, but a totally different grouping than his cousin Teddy Roosevelt. And Roosevelt clashed with Churchill through the entire war. And indeed, I'm bringing this up because we have this is the situation we face today. Except the difference is the United States has been virtually captured, in particular under the Obama presidency. And we're being used in much the same way that Churchill wanted to use the Nazis to destroy first Russia. And that's why we delayed the Western Front over and over and over again. That was not Roosevelt's policy. That was not Eisenhower's policy. They had a completely different policy. But of course, the Normandy landing was launched from the British Isles. So we had to have some cooperation from the British. And the British would not cooperate. Now they plan to use us directly in a certain sense. Draw us into a thermonuclear confrontation, which they may have the illusion wouldn't be tripped off. They're wrong. Now we're being sold the idea that this is a revolution in Ukraine. And that's what's going on right now as we sit here. That's the basic propaganda line. And you better realize it's a propaganda line. Where this will lead is, I don't know in the specific case. Will it be calmed down? Won't it be calmed down? In some ways, that's not the relevant matter. What the relevant matter is Syria is going to be heated up. Japan versus China is going to be heated up. Because the policy, the intention, is to bring us to thermonuclear confrontation and war in order to establish the ongoing power of the transatlantic Wall Street, London, financial control now. Because they're operating from the standpoint of a dead system. Whatever anybody thinks, there's no recovery. You have a further looting, and part of it is, of course, they'd like to loot Ukraine and Russia and so on and so forth. But you have a further looting, or what Lynn calls a bail-in. Now everybody knows the bailout won't work anymore. So what are we going to have? The bail-in. What does that mean? Take the money out of pension funds. Take it out of savings accounts, as they did in Cyprus and Greece. Take a small business running its cash flow through a bank, and they're only insured up to $250,000. Now they either spread their cash out into a bunch of different banks, which of course makes the business much more difficult to run, or they keep the money in one bank and they may find that they don't have it. It's been bailed in or it's been temporarily escrowed. And so the economy is under immediate collapse. 95% of the American population has less net wealth than we did 5 years ago. Over half have less than a year's income that they can rely on as a net, a safety net. The job crisis has not been answered. You look at then you look at Europe, Spain, Greece, Italy, you've got unemployment figures that are historic. And who knows what it is in the United States. This is what we're faced with. And this is what's driving what Lynn is getting at, and we have to recognize that we're not going to be able to stop the war. In many ways, as Lynn said last night, we may stop a war in Ukraine. Maybe Putin will have the same response, or a response that at least wants to avoid war temporarily. But if we keep pushing Russia, they're going to go to war at some point or other. They have never allowed themselves to be conquered. Certainly not in the last 500 years. And that's an interesting point to keep in mind, because I'm going to read you some, get an idea of the British mind. I'm going to read you some quotes from a character who played a very big role in the 20th century, a little bit later. So this is what we're faced with. Because if we solve the problem in Ukraine, and that's going to be, I don't know if we're going to solve the problem if we put the war off, but if we ensconce the present opposition into power, there are many possibilities. A civil war, because there's support for the sitting president in eastern Ukraine, which has a significant ethnic Russian population, and is pro-Russia. It's also the heart of Ukrainian industry. And you know, Americans sit back like it's a hockey game. Well, you know, we won this one. You know, the Russians lost in the hockey game at the Olympics, they lost in Ukraine, they're on a losing streak. We're doing better. We came out ahead. This is real moral stupidity. I think somebody asked Lynn last night, what's the problem with the American population? They said, well, it's stupidity. In a certain sense, being stupid is immoral. But somehow people are more insulted when you say they're stupid than if you say they're immoral. Oh, immoral, everybody's immoral, but don't call me stupid. That's what people think these days. But if we stop it in Ukraine, Syria could heat up, because they want to heat it up. There's now a resolution that passed the UN for humanitarian aid, agreed to get into some of these cities. Well, you know, here's the point to think about again. In Ukraine, we're supporting fascists. Why is it that people don't even know that? Well, the media doesn't report it, or they report it in a buried fashion. Well, why don't you find out? We've got the story on it. We've got a fact sheet. Why don't you ask yourself, if it's buried in an article, why do I accept fascism even if it's buried in the article? Why do I accept the lie that we allied with the Russians in World War II, but they're just as bad as the Nazis? Why do we believe that? If that was true, why didn't we do what General Patton wanted and just keep fighting? If they're as bad as Hitler, the truth is they're not as bad as Hitler. Putin is not Adolf Hitler. I'll stake my political career on it. Not much of a career, but anyway. I will forecast that Putin will not intentionally, as a matter of policy, slaughter 20, 30, 40 million people. I'll stick with that. If somebody can come back to me and tell me that I'm wrong someday in the future, yeah, I'm here. You can tell me. But we put up with this stuff. The Chinese are our enemy. Okay? We put up with it. Now, the interesting thing is, in Ukraine we're backing fascists. What are we doing in Syria? We're spending $3 million to pay a payroll of jihadists and al-Qaeda. Now, did you ever think we'd be paying the salaries of the people who organized the 9/11? And why doesn't that make people a little uncomfortable? Maybe we now view the plane flying into the North Tower as a protest. Maybe they were freedom fighters.
They're just expressing themselves.
Yeah, right. So now we can support their descendants. Now, the fact of the matter is, there is a certain reality. A lot of the people in this country are angry at Obama. Now, it might be largely what we say inchoate. It's unclear. But they're angry. So they'll say it's this, it's the NSA scandal, it's Obamacare, it's executive orders, it's this, that, and the other thing. Now, what we have to do is turn that into something else. We have to turn it into a different kind of revolution, where we change the way people think about mankind. We understand that humanity is predicated on the creative powers of the human mind. And these are unique. And they're unique in a way that we can discuss a little bit more at some other time when people are, I'm not going to go into all of this tonight. But you have to recognize that the mind, and this is where you really hit the 20th century. Because the 20th century in particular has undermined this view. Intentionally. There partly was a psychological war. Now, admittedly, human beings have a certain proclivity. Because in a certain sense, we haven't realized our full potentiality as human beings. But at the same time, it's this kind of outlook. That there are most of the human species is just, condemned to an animal-like existence. Pleasure and pain, reproduction, death. And a few who are genetically better endowed are meant to rule. Now, the American Republic was not built on that, but that's increasingly the outlook. And it's been increasingly the outlook over the course of the 20th century in particular. The reality is that the human mind is not simply the brain or the central nervous system. The brain is our sensory apparatus. It interprets the sense data. And there's more to it, and some of it to be discovered. Because without the brain, you wouldn't have a mind. But the mind is something more than the sum of the physiological parts of the brain. We're not just a bunch of firing neurons. There's something else that goes on in no other animal. We have the ability to generate conceptions about the way the world actually works and to use them to change our relationship to nature. And discover principles, universal principles, like electromagnetism, or gravity, or some others, like life. We know that there's a principle of life that exists in the universe that generates life and gives life unique qualities that are not simply explicable by the parts, by the chemical elements. We don't yet fully know what it is, but we know it exists. We know that there's a creative development. The universe develops. Life develops biologically, historically. The universe develops. Now, and you have a great irony in a certain sense, because when we talk about the universe as a whole, people think we're talking about all kinds of inanimate objects. And they are inanimate. But as a whole, the universe generates higher forms of organization and greater forms of energy density And as we act to discover those principles, we find those existences in the universe. We find that those principles open up areas of the universe, and that the development of the human mind coheres, the discoveries of the human mind cohere with the development of the universe. Now, in a very interesting way, what that tells you is something that goes to some of the core of the 20th century. Because what that tells you, if you think about it, is that science, properly understood, and now I'm not talking about physics alone, science encompassing life and the creative development of the universe, though that discovery of those principles occurs in the same way that classical composition of drama, music, painting occurs. It's the same mental process, and therefore it reflects the same capability. It reflects the same principles. And if anything, classical art or composition that is of this developmental sort, I'm not talking about any music. For example, you can say definitively that, we'll start off with something that might not upset too many people. Okay, the Gregorian chant is not classical composition. We can be ecumenical, and I can tell you that Hasidic hymns are not classical composition. Now let's get to more serious territory. The Beatles are not classical composition. They destroy the mind, let alone the Rolling Stones, metal rock, acid rock, rock rock, etc. There's absolutely no progressive development whatsoever, including jazz. And these are the things that people don't like to discuss, because they say, well, how can you say that? It's all a matter of taste. Well, that's exactly where the problem comes up, because it's not a matter of taste. It's a matter of what's true and what's not. It's a matter of how the mind works and what the principles of creative development are. Now, lest anyone think this is, you know, some bizarre trip, I'm just going to give you an idea. Some of the older members and older contacts will probably know some of this already, but it's worth bringing up again, I think, to remind people. And you know, throughout the 20th century, there has been, let's say, greater study of how to control populations, larger populations, as the human populations have gotten larger and so forth, than ever before. One of the things that makes Bertrand Russell, a British philosopher, for those of you who don't know, but one of the leading political figures of the 20th century, when he, after certain things that I'll just mention later, when he had established his career, and of course this was the Russell family of Lord John Russell, this is the Earl of Bedford. This is one of the leading British aristocrats who became a major figure in so-called British philosophy and really global philosophical developments. Okay, and I'll come back to some of that to open up for maybe further times in the future. But in the 1920s, after he had established his precedence of a certain kind, he said, look, my main field of inquiry now is mass psychology. The main thing I want to look at is how we can use the developing science of sociology, psychology, in conjunction with his own already methodological view, to control populations, to define education. And you have to watch it, because people like Russell are smart enough to use the word mind and creativity, and then they say, well, the way this is done is behaviorism. He was a student of a follower of J.B. Watson's educational methods. He was the founder of behaviorist psychological theory. And he implemented this. By the way, he implemented it on his own children. He implemented it in a school that he and his wife ran. But more than that, he, and even later in the early phases, he was actually, if you really want to understand the guy, he was one of the leading figures of what you would call the early 20th century counterculture. This is the D.H. Lawrence, T.S. Eliot. These were his comrades in things called the Cliveden set, the Bloomsbury set. These were the avant-garde. They believed in open marriages, free sex, drug usage, complete, quote, liberals. And in the 1960s, 50s and 60s, under the threat of nuclear conflict, Russell was one of the leading people pulling together the so-called counterculture, the new left, the anti-nuclear movement. As an anti-war movement? No, as an anti-science and technology movement. He called himself a guild socialist. What does a guild socialist mean? Guild socialism is 14th century medieval guilds, you know, crafts. He hated the modern era. He hated industrialism. He hated Russia. He hated the United States, but he loved China. And now we're talking about really imperial China. He loved Mao. He probably was one of the people who educated Mao. He and John Dewey held classes in China, and amongst the people attending the classes was Chou En-lai, who went a different direction, but Mao and some of Mao's contemporaries. And he supported Mao when he wanted to bomb the Soviet Union. This is why we call him the most evil man of the 20th century. He was part of the leading edge, and it goes back, and this is important to note, because indeed, the typical line you'll get from his biographers and his defenders is, well, he got weird. You know, he was a great philosopher, a great figure in British philosophy, but later on, yes, he was a pacifist, but he went off the deep end at certain points, and then he went crazy at the end of his life. He was manipulated by this young guy, Ralph, that worked with him, Schurnemann, an American, but he was a great philosopher. Well, my point is, he was the most evil philosopher. Far more important than the crazy existentialists that people often talk about. Because most of the way we look at mankind today, existentialism takes advantage of the purposelessness of life. But the basis of the purposelessness of life is the philosophical outlook that was created by Bertrand Russell. We sometimes call it logical positivism. You can call it mathematical logical outlook. Because what did Russell think? That science was the great future, but in the form of empirical knowledge, sense certainty, and mathematical formulations, axiomatic mathematical systems. And he wrote what made him famous was something called Principia Mathematica, which was an axiomatization of arithmetic, which he saw as the only language in which science could be written. And that has been the outlook for over 100 years. This was published in about 1910, though the work on it began in 1900. And that was his outlook. That was the basis for the development of the new left, of the counterculture of the 1960s and forward. Now, let me give you one idea, because some of you may have heard of this. It starts with a book that came out in 1980, which people have heard of, The Aquarian Conspiracy, by a woman named Marilyn Ferguson. Now, I'm not going to go into her, because her thing comes, it was a famous kind of guide to the counterculture, to the new life, you know, free sexuality, free drugs, give up industrialism, give up science, human development has been for naught. Actually, her work came from something done at Stanford, the Stanford Research Institute, under a guy named Willis Harmon, whose name I... Now, this is not for the purposes of just some populist conspiracy theory, you know, that people can get off on. This is to give you something else. Because the real conspiracy is not what people think. It's precisely to establish a certain set of ideas, axioms about human nature that people just accept as true. And when they're pushed to the wall, They say, no, this is what runs the world. I'm a slave. I'm just another animal trying to stay alive. Now, the thing that the Stanford study begins with the argument that the fundamental conception of what mankind is and the image that mankind has of itself determine the behavior of mankind. To change mankind's behavior away from industrialism into, quote, spiritualism, unquote, one must first force a change in mankind's self-image. Now you get an idea why LaRouche, this is where LaRouche fights the war. This is strategy. It's not other stuff. It's not how do you get this guy to change and where do you deploy this guy. This is what strategy is all about. Now, this is a quote. Quote, image and fundamental conceptions of human nature and potentialities can have enormous power in shaping the values and actions in a society. We have attempted this study to illuminate the ways our present society, its citizens and institutions have been shaped by the underlying myths and images of the past and present. And we use the image of man, or man in the universe, to refer to the set of assumptions held about human beings' origin, nature, abilities, and characteristics, relationships with others, and place in the universe. And it goes on in that vein. I'm not, obviously not going to read it. This is the study. This is the strategic outlook of one of the main think tanks in the United States. This is in the, not 1980, before 1980. This is where the war is fought and lost. When people believe things like the Ukrainian fascists are not fascists. They're not shaped by their history, by their image of the fact that they say Ukraine for Ukrainians. That's not anything. We can analyze it from a geopolitical standpoint. Now let me give you an idea of what they come up to as a sort of conclusion and see what you think of that. The Stanford planners point out that the industrial nation-state is the one supporting the image of economic man. The industrial state at this point has immense drive but no direction. Marvelous capacity to get there but no idea where it is going. Then it says, despite the pessimism implied by a lagging dominant image, there are numerous indications that a new anticipatory image of humankind may be emerging. And in this case, obviously they're talking about it to create it. Youth involvement in political processes, women's liberation movement, black consciousness, etc. Youth rebellion against societal wrongs, emerging interest in the social responsibility of business, the generation gap implying a changing paradigm, the anti-technological bias of many young people, experimentation with new family structures and interpersonal relationships, the emergence of communes as alternate lifestyles, the emergence of the conservation ecology movement, a surge in interest in Eastern religious and philosophical perspectives, a new renewed interest in fundamentalist Christianity, labor union concerns with quality of the work environment, an increasing interest in meditation and other spiritual disciplines, the increasing importance of, quote, self-realization processes. These desperate trends do not, when taken individually, signify the emergence of a new image of human being. Yet, when they are considered collectively, they suggest substantial societal stirrings which may eventually emerge into a new and guiding image. Okay? Now, I think if you really think about it, that's a little on the stunning side. And if we don't fight the battle at that level, then it's not really a war. It's not really a battle. We're fighting on one plane, and the enemy's fighting on a different plane. And we're never the plane shall meet. We'll get nowhere. Because every time you think you've won a battle, if you haven't made the relevant progress in changing the conception of the nature of mankind, you will get nowhere. You know, I could talk here about what we need to do. We need to impeach Obama this week, by next Saturday. What's the point? Am I making a prediction? Not really. I wish I could. But But I am saying that's the perspective that we have to have. No one else has that perspective. It's not a question of whether it's realistic. It's realistic in the sense that every day he's in office, we're threatened with destruction. That's the realism of it. And so you say, no, we're not just talking about we don't like him, we're waiting to win the Republican Party, to win the House, I mean, not the House, the Senate, this November. That's bull. They're not going to do it no matter what. Besides that, we don't have the time to wait. We can't wait till November or January when they get whatever happens. We have to have the sense that the world is at stake at this point. The future is at stake. And we have to, at the same time, give people a sense of the future. What are we talking about? We have the potential to do all kinds of things. In a sense, what scientific development there has been, the discovery of electromagnetism in the 19th century, the development of electricity, and the ability to power and drive electricity, creating all kinds of new resources, new capabilities to form metal alloys, new processes. Then the introduction, which means that we moved into a different phase of chemistry, where we now were not limited to the elements themselves and the way in which the elements interacted as along the lines of the periodic table. But now we were in a position to know what was the basis of the bonds and the breaking of the bonds, and in fact to go even further, to in many cases use the processes by which elements transform themselves to create more and less or different kinds of processes, different kinds of compounds, different ratios of elements. And this was the nuclear world. We discovered a whole different world of radiation. And what is really radiation? Radiation is the process of transformation of elements. It's what occurs when elements are transforming. Now we have a different handle on the creativity of the universe. We have the American system under Hamilton, which LaRouche has talked about extensively recently. And Hamilton had the idea of ongoing development of the productive powers of labor, or what he called artificial labor, science and technology. That all money does is facilitate the transfer and the activity of relevant exchange and division of labor that facilitates the growth in the physical economy. As basically facilitates it, by that I don't mean makes profit. I mean it simply allows the proper exchanges to occur so that the economy can function as a whole. Now what Hamilton didn't know was the depth of power over natural processes that the human species was capable of, because he had no idea. He might have had a glimmer of electricity. He certainly didn't have a full-blown idea of electromagnetism. He was dead by the time Oersted gave some of the first examples. And he certainly didn't know about nuclear processes. Now this gives you a rate of change in human productivity that's otherwise unheard of. And you have to give people that sense, as we've discussed with, you know, we had some classes here on thermonuclear fusion. You know, and the reality that we can do this at a level we've never thought of before with the introduction of helium-3, which gives you a different fusion process. And by the way, fusion occurs. We're not just talking now about nuclear fission, which produces elements and so forth, but once you enter a different domain, you're capable of generating nuclear fusions. And fusion generally can occur under certain circumstances all the way up to iron, though these things would obviously get to be. But as we learn more and more, we can generate more and more of those circumstances. There's a whole array of questions, which mean going at a deeper understanding of what we call quantum theory, which was really generated by Planck and Einstein at the beginning of the 20th century. In fact, there are two major events in 1900, literally, that occur. One, is Planck's discovery of the quantum, or his paper expressing the discovery of the quantum, therefore opening up a whole different understanding of the way processes occur in nature. And number two was the counter-deployment by really people related to Russell, some of whom were fooled by Russell, David Hilbert, but also going back to people like Weierstrass, who had launched an attack on the tradition of real scientific activity of people like Riemann, later Einstein and Planck. In the summer of 1900, they listed a series of problems to be solved, all of which oriented to the mathematization of physics and chemistry, and particularly physics, and then the reduction of chemistry to physics. And the argument was we have to have a mathematization of it. That's where the fundamental truth lies. And that was explicitly an attack on people like Planck and Einstein, who, by the way, surprisingly enough, despite the mythology about Einstein, were against the idea that physics was subordinated to mathematics, that you had to understand mathematical physics. Now, I'll give you an idea what this guy Russell was like politically. Okay, I want to, for example, and also I think this should be a lesson as to how to look at politics, okay? Because, you know, if I say, well, the British are manipulating the United States, they're manipulating Russia, Wall Street, so, you know, people say, oh, you know, how could it be this? Well, let me give you an idea what Russell, what was Russell's position? He was a pacifist during World War I. He served some time in jail. He basically organized people against the draft. And there were some interesting things that were done that were highly dubious. And indeed, by the way, he was a big, one of the reasons was he was a big proponent of Germany at the time. They also ran a certain kind of introduction of a work camp. In other words, what they did with people who didn't serve in sort of were conscientious objectors, but they put them in work camps. And that was their penalty, so to speak. And they had to produce, you know, active things for the home front and so on and so forth. But anyway, what was his position on World War, on Hitler during the 1930s? Well, there's just a letter that the Siemens-Wiesenthal group got a hold of, where he says, you know, if the Germans come in, why don't we just invite them to dinner? That would be the best way to deal with them. And then they would just, they would just become calm and we could deal with that. I know what it is. This is what he thinks about Germany in about 1936. Okay, basically his line was that we should face the Nazis unarmed. Clearly such a view was not open to Russell, who were to defend the pacifist view, not on the basis of an unshakable categorical principle, which is some of the people were doing, but rather as the outcome of an entirely rational calculation of foreseeable consequences. This is probably why he felt obliged to present utterly incredible assessments of the likely behavior of the Nazi regime when faced with defenseless people. The consequences of facing the Nazis unarmed, he had to pretend, were really not as bad as people feared. Given time, the worst that could happen was that we would find ourselves living under a liberal democracy governed by the Germans rather than the British, so that if we could educate our pride, there would be nothing to prevent us accepting the consequences of pacifism. In order to make this even slightly plausible, he was forced to essentially emphasize the civilized nature of the German people. In intelligence, courage, and public spirit, they surpass all other nations.
At the moment, it is true they have an abominable government, but so should we have if we had suffered as they have since 1918. Governments are not eternal, but the merits of the Germans are important to mankind. The German nation must not be identified with Hitler, etc. It is argued that if all Germany's just claims are met in a friendly spirit, the militaristic temper, which is now dominant, will gradually become softened. This may, of course, be true. I confess I think it is improbable that the treatment of the defenseless opponents within the Reich suggests the mentality of a bully. The probability upon which we have to act seems to be that Germany will engage in an aggressive war whenever the chance of victory is judged to be good. How these observations are compatible with the claims he makes elsewhere in the book that the Nazis will give up their army rather than face being laughed at, that they will not attack an unarmed nation, and that they will refrain from persecuting political opponents in the countries they occupy is not explained. Now the only thing that really explains this, the author of this is not, what he presents is true. Russell was an appeaser. Russell's view was that we could live with the Nazis. He hated the Russians. This was the objective of British geopolitical policy, to turn the Germans against the Russians and let them destroy each other. That's the inconsistency in Russell. Most of what he had to say had nothing to do as actual beliefs, and you can see by the massive inconsistency. One day he says one thing, the next day he says something else. I'll give you a really good example of it. In February of 1937, he made isolationism the theme of his maiden speech in the House of Lords, where he supported Lord Arnold's resolution in favor of British neutrality in the next war, i.e. World War II. The general assumption was that this would be between Germany and the Soviet Union. But as Russell made clear in a letter to Gilbert Murray, he was in favor of British neutrality even in a war between Germany and France. Having remained a pacifist while the Germans were invading in 1914, I do not see why I should cease to be one if they do it again. He maintained this position throughout the German Anschluss with Austria, the Munich crisis, the invasion of Czechoslovakia and Poland. Only in the spring of 1940, after the phony war, British troops were finally engaged with Germany, did Russell abandon his pacifist stance, much like Churchill. He turned when he realized that the Nazis were not going to give the British a free ride. Then I'll give you another sense of it. Russell's image of himself as the last survivor of a bygone age, the last representative of the tradition of aristocratic rebelliousness, recurs in much of his writings. Then he writes a letter to one of his friends, and he says, I would like to be part of, and now I'm prepared to fight. This is 1940. Okay? Now, of course, even this author says, he says he's willing to fight now, but why? The fact is he can't square this with the fact that he, in fact, had said that he didn't want to fight. He could somehow put up with the Russians coming in, the Germans coming in, and that was livable to him. So you have to ask yourself, how is he saying, here's a good example. I have now come to realize that I, in common with almost everybody else, underestimated the power of Hitler. I did not really believe he could invade England, and the suggestion that he could attack the United States would have seemed to me utterly fantastic. He has now shown that he will go on in his attempt to dominate the world. Terrible as is the cost of war, whoever wins, I think this is one of those rare cases in which the cost of passivity is even greater. If I were of military age, I should fight, blah, blah, blah. The impression that he had not really considered the possibility of a Nazi invasion of England is, of course, false. In 1936, Russell had not only considered it, but argued that it was a lesser evil than a mechanized scientific war. Nor was the thought new to him that Hitler would go on to expand the Reich until stopped by a superior force. And then he points out places where he wrote about it. So it's all, the thing that this guy doesn't want to see about Russell is it's all a lie. He doesn't want to go against Germany. because he wants the Nazis to fight the Soviets. And his hatred of the Russians goes back, the Soviets, goes back to his first visit to the Soviet Union in 1919 or 1920. And what you get is not a hatred of the Soviet Union. He hates the Russian people. He hates the peasantry. He hates the drive for industrialization. He hates America. He says it on every visit to the United States. I'm not going to try to dig up every quote. We're unthinking, boorish, and so on and so forth. And what he hates is the industrialized nation. He wants to go back to a pre-industrial period, which is the outlook of every aristocrat and oligarch and financier of any sort in the world. That's what we're dealing with. Look at their view of the third world. Look at their view of Africa. Now, I'll give you an idea, give you a sense of inconsistency. And you have to, the only way to look at this is, what is British imperial policy? What is their actual, what's driving, what's the intention? Because here's a guy who was a pacifist in World War I. He didn't want to fight the Nazis. He was forced to fight the Nazis. Okay? And then he finally did. Okay? Now, a good thing to look at, I don't know how much... Okay. In an article, "What Should Be British Policy Towards Russia?" in September of 1945, Russell argued that since before long, Russia, no doubt, will have as good or bad a bomb as that of the Americans. It was of fundamental importance that Soviet power be contained quickly, and asserted that this could not be achieved by a policy of appeasement such as we pursued towards Germany until after Munich, and in his case, until 1940. A month later, he published an article called "What America Could Do with the Atom Bomb," in which he made clear how he imagined Soviet power to be contained. Whatever measures are to be taken to prevent another world war must be taken during the brief period of American supremacy and must be enforced by a vigorous use of that supremacy. The immense power for good or ill conferred by the atomic bomb should be used by the Americans wisely and with no undue shrinking from the responsibilities which this power confers. In a letter on September the 1st, "I think Stalin has inherited Hitler's ambition for world dictatorship. One must expect a war between the U.S. and the Soviets, which will begin with the total destruction of London. I think the war will last 30 years and leave a world civilized, without civilized people, from which everything will have to be built afresh. There is one thing and one thing only which could save the world, and that is the thing I should not dream of advocating. It is that America should make war on Russia during the next 2 years and establish a world empire by means of the atomic bomb." In November, he gave a more measured assessment, hoping the Soviets would see it. In "What America Could Do with the Atom Bomb," he went so far as to say that he preferred all the chaos and destruction of a war conducted by means of the atomic bomb to the universal domination of a government having the evil characteristics of the Nazis. Now, apply that to today. Russia is now being Sovietized, according to the Obama White House. If that's Adolf Hitler, and Russell is the kind of policy the British actually have, then they're calling for the use of nuclear weapons. And at least that's a hypothesis that one should take seriously. In the same article, he proposed an international confederation led by the United States, which would enforce a monopoly on nuclear weapons. Russia should be invited to join this confederation, and if it refused, quote, "the conditions for a justifiable war would all be fulfilled. A casus belli would not be difficult to find," end quote. Okay? Russell's attitude to the Soviet Union was, during the early phases of the Cold War at least, even closer to Winston Churchill than it was to the Labor government. And he wanted as Russell put it in another letter, "I hate the Soviet government too much for sanity," meaning his own sanity. The policy that he had earlier stated he would never dream of advocating, that of using the atom bomb to establish American hegemony, he now began to advocate openly and insistently. In 1947, by the way, I'm making a point because it's generally been covered that Russell said this in 1946 in the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists. You use the atomic bomb. It's generally viewed that he did this one time, or that was it, because then the Russians got the bomb. He said this every time, 45, 46, 47, 48, and I'll show you something else. Even after the Soviets got the bomb, he said, if we can ever establish superiority, I would advocate it again. And we have people now who think we have superiority. Okay? Well, let me just... I think you would get so powerful an alliance that you could turn to Russia and say, it is open to you to join this alliance if you will agree to it. If you will not join us, we shall go to war with you. I'm inclined to think Russia would acquiesce. If not, provided this is done soon, the world might survive the resulting war and emerge with a single government such as the world needs. This is British policy. It's not just Russell's policy. This is what you see. This is why he represents this in the starkest terms. He writes a letter to an American academic, Walter Marseille. This is a few months later, so it would be sometime in 47, I guess. Russell said he did not, after all, think Russians would acquiesce. On the contrary, I do not think the Russians will yield without war. And in this war, he thought the Russians, even without atomic bombs, will be able to destroy big towns in England. Nevertheless, even at such a price, I think a war would be worthwhile, for I have no doubt that America would win in the end. Communism must be wiped out, and world government must be established. That's quote, unquote. Okay? And, you know, I don't know how much more I want to go on with this, but even the author, who's a liberal, who says, you know, look, the Russians did expand, he said, look, there's no way the Soviet Union was in no position to embark on an invasion of Western Europe. Russell was also mistaken about the strength of the American arsenal. Thus, as Russell himself came to realize, the USA, even if it was prepared to threaten the Soviets with an atomic bomb, could not do so. In fact, Russell mentions that conversations with professional strategists had convinced him that the USA needed two more years to make such a threat credible. Therefore, the most dangerous period for us is the next 2 years. In other words, that we could maintain the superiority long enough to bomb Russia. Okay? Now, I'll give you one last thing on this, because I think, he later says, you know, what this omits is that in the period from 45 to 48, when Russell publicly advocated a policy of threatening the Soviet Union with atomic weapons on no fewer than 12 occasions, his hatred and fear of Soviet communism were such that he defended such a policy, not only on the grounds that it would prevent the possibility of an armed conflict involving two atomic powers, but also on the grounds that it would prevent Soviet conquest of Western Europe, and so on. And either we must have a war against Russia before she has the atom bomb, or we will have to lie down and let them govern us. And so he's just listing examples. Now, and he says over and over again, the main point, if there is war, the main issue should be the creation of an international government. And if this is its outcome, then the next great war may be the last. So you get this whole, you know, it's all of one piece. Okay, this is empire. They don't care about the British Isles. That's not the point. The point is the imperial control. On top, you know, that's the essence of the whole thing. Horror of the thought of Russian. And of course, all of this is ridiculous. There was no threat of, at that point, of a Russian takeover. Now, what happened is, in 1953, he's interviewed, and he basically says, oh, I never said that. I always said threaten. We talk about logic chopping. He said, I always said we should threaten the Russians. I never said we should bomb them. Okay? And then the guy on the interview show pulls out the letter that I read to you from this guy, Walter Marseille. And it says, he says, you say here that you're not talking about threatening, you're talking about a preventative war. And he says, oh, God, my God, yes, I guess you're right about that. And then he actually tries to say that he forgot that he had written the letter. Here, I'll give you a... Oh, here we go. In a letter following the... Oh, this is following the broadcast of the interview with this guy, Freeman Russell. Anyway, I can't find that, but then he writes in this letter, the arms race became inevitable unless drastic measures were taken to avoid it. That is why in late 1948 I suggested the remedy might be the immediate war by the United States on Russia, blah, blah, blah. At the time I gave this advice, I gave it so casually, without any real hope that it would be followed, that I soon forgot I had given it. I had mentioned it in a private letter and again in a speech that I did not know was to be the subject of dissection by the press. When later the recipient of the letter asked me for permission to publish it, I said, as I usually do, without consideration of the contents, that if he wished he might publish it. He did so, and to my surprise I learned of my earlier suggestion. I had also entirely forgotten about the above mentioned. So if you believe that, believe it. I mean, this is a guy who was no dummy. On the matter of bombing Russia, he forgot that he wrote it in a letter, not in a casual conversation. Okay? So this is, and what does Russell represent? He doesn't only represent an outlook. He represents a conception of mankind, that we should all be part of a single empire ruled on an international basis, in which most of us should realize that we're not part of the aristocracy, we're not as well endowed, and we should simply serve that purpose. Now, in the 1960s and 70s, not 70, he died in 1960, one of the things about these people, he lived to be 98 years old. He was born in 1872 and he died in 1970. So you can say he covers a lot of territory. But in a certain sense, part of why I went over this part of things was to give you an idea of where we are now. This is the thinking that dominates all this geopolitical discussion. Henry Kissinger, Brzezinski, Dick Cheney, the neocons, the whole crowd. This is their dominant outlook. They will go for thermonuclear war, and they will simply calculate perhaps they could survive. And if they don't, if no one survives, they're almost as happy. So I think I'll just leave it at that. And maybe the next time we can go more into what I think is even more fundamental, which is the philosophical outlook that he was the creator of. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't understand why you said that Russell was in favor of Mao, or Mao was a student.
Yeah.
Russell, why? Because, you know, my understanding is Mao was, you know, communist China and so forth.
He didn't see, no, this is naive. I mean, he had a certain, like a lot of people, he picked up certain elements of, quote, communism. But what you really get from Mao is an anti-industrial outlook, a revolution based on the peasantry, not the working class, not that I'm in favor of, it had none, it was called Marxism. It was not Marxism. It was only Marxism in the sense that he applied a certain class analysis to the peasantry and so on and so forth. He had a feudal conception of the development of China, and that's what Russell and company liked about China was its backwardness. And they saw Maoism, not Sun Yat-sen. They viewed Sun Yat-sen as a problem. That's why they supported Mao earlier. And, you know, Russell was a great devotee of the civilized nature of the Chinese culture. That it was more polite, it was more aesthetically oriented, people knew their place. And that was Mao. Mao was a, you know, a Jacobin is a much better way to look at it.
My also because Mao is known for the biggest genocide, that he killed 70 million people, which was...
It could be, but, you know, yeah. I think what you get from these characters is they are hardcore anti-science, anti-industry, anti-nation state, That's partly how I don't know if I have the somewhere there's a quote that one of these guys, I think it's Mackinder, okay, who says, you know, when you look from Western and Central Europe, you look across the great Eurasian plains, and you see, as far as the eye can see, villages, peasants, that's what's in your mind. You look past the industrialization. That was Russell's horror at Russia, was the intense effort in industrialization. He went there during the electrification project and so on and so forth. That was a brutal time. There's no two ways about that. But there was brutality all over the place. I'm not excusing it. I wouldn't say that. But he had it was an irrational hatred of Eurasian development. And that's why he had a completely different position on the Nazis. He had no problem with the Nazis, except when they threatened to not be controllable.
America has many issues with its culture, education system, foreign policy, economic, etc., under oligarchy's strategy. Even if the Glass-Steagall Act is restored, another Clinton can come and allow it to repeal again. Even if Obama is impeached, we don't know the next president's characteristic. I think America really needs another revolution to overcome with the issues. And if so, how could we move forward with it?
Well, I think that's true, except that I don't think, the thing is, don't think about them all separated out. In other words, the organizing that we do for Glass-Steagall, we don't handle it as an issue. We say, you have to have, first of all, we refer to the Franklin Roosevelt side of things. How is this done? What did it change? And now bring it to an even fuller change. Open it up to the NAWAPA project, a full credit system, not a credit system that has to go around the way Roosevelt did. And Roosevelt did a brilliant job, but there was a limit because he couldn't quite simply take over the Federal Reserve. It had been legislated, and that wasn't an easy thing to get rid of. So we have to, that's why I'm raising here, and what you'll see in Lynn's latest paper, is we have to go at the conception of the human mind. And what makes us human is not just surviving and being alive. That we need. You can't do anything if you don't have that. Okay? But we have to take the quality that's unique in the human mind and make that the center of education, the center of economic development, the center, and we make that the fight in all of the what seem to be separate issues. Okay? So that's the fight we are making. That's why I'm making the point. It's a fight against the strategy is a fight against what Russell represents. And I'll tell you, Russell's outlook is far and away the dominant philosophical outlook in the entire industrialized world. It has tremendous impact in Russia and Ukraine, tremendous impact in the English-speaking world throughout. The only place it's not hegemonic is in the underdeveloped sector, in India, even a little bit in India. But in Africa, South America, because it's so overtly aristocratic that you're not going to get much support for it. But if you take most of the colleges in the United States, the math department, the science department, the philosophy departments, the sociology department, you're going to find that some version of this kind of outlook is the hegemonic outlook. And that's what you have to break the back of. We have to win a certain battle that we used to call, we have to win the battle for epistemological or intellectual hegemony. We have to be the leading force intellectually, philosophically, culturally.
Yeah. I was going to say, I was his age, you're 18, right? That was 1969, 52. I actually had one of Bertrand Russell's leading acolytes as my philosophy 101 professor at Brooklyn College. His name was Paul Edwards. And I mentioned this, of course, in the course of later finding out that, and Russell is dominant, just what you said there, and I do have one other question besides what I'm going to say now. Russell taught at UCLA in the late 30s, early 40s. He taught at Harvard, he taught at the University of Chicago. One place he didn't teach where he had signed a contract. This is almost unknown. He signed a contract to teach at City College of New York, and the Catholic Church and a bunch of other people got up in arms and started a campaign, a public campaign, to say if this guy is allowed to teach, the crime rate will go up because he teaches deviance, he teaches immorality, he teaches free, you know, everything. And his contract was ripped up and was never allowed to teach in Brooklyn, which is probably why some of us survived. Education, Bertrand Russell was not allowed in the system. The professor I had was his leading defender, saying that was a violation of academic freedom and all this other stuff. But it's very interesting. But my question is, in the stuff we've written over the years on Bertrand Russell, especially in the book on the New Dark Ages, there's discussion of how Russell was like your greeny, tear down all technology, get rid of, you know, go back to nature, blah, blah, blah. But then there's another faction of the oligarchy that we refer to as H.G. Wells, that said, A, we need technology, we just got to keep it secret from everyone else, so the oligarchy can have the weapons and, you know, laud it over the world. But then Bertrand Russell's came back and said, well, A, if you have it, the word's going to leak out and people's going to want it, and you can't even have it because then everyone else is going to want it, and you ain't going to be able to keep it secret. So the question, Phil, is where does this stand now? Is there still...
I think the basic, the hegemonic outlook, look, there, I think Machiavelli knew this, it goes way back, that, you know, in a certain sense, if you have a vibrant republic, you're going to get scientific development. And therefore, the oligarchy is going to have to decide ways to both get the technology and control it. Okay, I'll give you a good example of this that comes up. Their preference by far, and I think increasingly the outlook is, look, any form of science, I think their basic outlook is a Russellian outlook. Any form of scientific development, any form of technology is bad. On the other hand, if you're going to have it, it's going to mainly be used for social control. If you think about the way the computer technologies are largely used today, they're usually mostly for social control. Social media, video, you know, computer games, etc., etc. Most of the work, look, the biggest supercomputer use in the world today is Hollywood. It's they use supercomputers on the animations. They take a tremendous amount of computer capability. Some of the biggest stuff being done from Silicon Valley goes into Hollywood and, of course, Wall Street. Okay, so I think their basic view is you've got to keep scientific development away, best not to have it. If you've got to have it, use it for social control. And that's what, look, Russell was I more and more look at it, he was certainly one. See, what you saw in the 20s and 30s, really, what the opposition was at City College, was because he was already pushing a counterculture. You know, his personal life was that. He had mistresses, people make it. But it wasn't so much, it was that he was advocating that as a lifestyle. Now, of course, there's great ironies in this, because when his first wife decided to have umpteen affairs, he completely freaked out and got, so this is just the humor of things.
The stuff I read on Russell was exactly along these lines, that the guy thought he was a great guy, and he was trying to write a book about how, what was the relationship between his ideas and his personal life.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened is by the time he got finished researching it, he completely freaked out because he realized Russell's kids went nuts.
Yeah.
They went crazy.
This is probably, this guy, Ray Monk.
Ray Monk, that's it.
That's it. This is insane. He does say, I think it might be in the other book, let me give you an idea of what happens to people who deal with Russell.
All his kids are dead now?
I think so.
Good.
Oh, no, it was in the preface. I have to bring you the other book. He says, oh, wait a minute. Here it is. Maybe this is it. In writing this book, I have had to confront, in a way that is new to me, my own reactions to my subject. For 10 years, I have, as it were, lived with Russell. And for the most part, it has been an uncomfortable experience. I find him inexhaustibly fascinating. And there are things about him that I admire tremendously. He's a British philosopher, the author. But as I have worked on this volume, two thoughts have dominated my reactions to him, which I am aware may have distorted my account of his life. The first is just how bad most of his writing on political, social, and moral questions is. Few who know Russell from his great writings on logic have taken the trouble to read the vast quantity of journalism that he produced in the second half of his life. Those who do would have been shocked at how sloppy and ill-considered much of it is. The second thought that has come to dominate my reaction to Russell, particularly in the latter half of his life, is how emotionally maimed he was. He was, it sometimes seems, simply not capable of loving another human being. Russell had what he considered to be an exalted conception of love, which he expressed in many places. Merging one ego. One might regard this as a harmlessly fanciful way of urging people to empathize, but Russell's relations with those close to him suggest another interpretation, that he was unable to conceive of loving a person unless he could regard that person as part of himself. In other words, loving another was, for him, inconceivable. He was, as it were, as indeed his epistemology maintains we all are, trapped inside the boundaries of his own ego. He could imagine, and frequently did imagine, extending those boundaries. But what he could not imagine was reaching out beyond them. Would that this were only a theoretical problem. But the experience of Russell's wives, children, and friends suggests that on this point, theory and practice combined in the most devastating manner.
Who wrote that?
Ray Monk. Yeah.
Comment by Victoria Newland.
Yeah.
The screw the EU or whatever it was. Apparently, she had been bragging that they'd spent $5 billion, I don't know, the State Department or whatever, you know, in Ukraine, I would suppose, roughly. That's a huge amount of money. And, you know, if there was any reaction to that. Plus, that I think that really showed she had the same kind of arrogance. Screw the EU, mm-hmm. and that I am, you know, one of the people that's pursuing this great game. In fact, mm-hmm. it was described as that in, you know, in somebody's article. Mm-hmm. And do you know if there's been, you know, reaction to that? I mean, to me, that's even unconstitutional.
Hey, oh, it's outrageous, but there hasn't been in the U.S. virtually no reaction. In fact, the whole crowd that she goes with, Samantha Power, Susan Rice, they're riding high right now. Now, the one thing I would say, there was somewhat of a reaction by Steinmeier, the German foreign minister. But even more, I'll tell you something, there is a reaction in Russia. Okay, and in a certain sense, I would be a little cautious about the fact that they're not saying that much publicly. In fact, you know, Putin called Obama up, there were certain discussions, but I don't think in this case the Russians are going to say much. There may be certain things that they simply do. And when they happen, we'll find out. If this goes on, there's no choice for them.
Yeah. You know, I just want to comment kind of going off of that, like, because, you know, my family's from Russia, and I've been watching the Russian news closely, what they've been saying about Ukraine, and what I found really interesting or kind of bad is basically, you know, they were talking about, you know, this is a straight coup by the U.S., specifically the U.S. and, you know, factions within the European Union. Then they had a Russian correspondent from Washington, D.C. debunk all that with just pure bullshit, you know, pure propaganda talking about, oh, the Obama administration is only focusing on Obamacare. They're in over their heads and they can't, you know, do anything, you know, so at the same time, the people in Moscow are saying, that's wrong, but they're saying it calmly, so I kind of agree with you, is whatever they're thinking, whatever they're saying, they're keeping it to themselves mm-hmm. right now. But we in America need to let them know that there's plenty of Americans here that, you know, we know what's going on. We've seen the history of these coups and takeovers by the CIA. We're not confused, we're not disoriented as to, oh, what's going on? You know, we know what happened in South America and Iran. You know, we need to let them know. Now it's happening in Ukraine and Russian borders. We know their motive. we know what they're trying to do, and they're trying to provoke peace. Mm-hmm. And we just need to let, you know, the Russian government and people know that, you know, we're not stupid, and, mm-hmm. you know, we understand.
Yes. I think, look, one thing I'll say just to add to that, because that is true. I think one of the things is we also have to give them a sense of this transatlantic economic collapse. There's too much belief that the system is somehow recovering itself, and they don't realize how desperate the British part of the, London and so forth. The second point is, Lyndon LaRouche is known in significant circles in Russia, and amongst people like Sergei Glazyev, Ivashov, and some of the think tanks, also in Ukraine, as an intellectually significant force in the United States. And so he is definitely making it clear, and then we have to spread the idea throughout the whole country that indeed there are people who understand that this is an insane path to go down.
My opinion is same-sex marriage is going to bring social problems in the future. Do you think this is a plan for depopulation?
In some sense, you know, sure, it's part of a whole cultural change. It's the idea that the development of society, the growth of population, is not important. That what's important is how do you feel? And do you enjoy the sex this way or do you enjoy the sex that way? You know, and that's what determines what you do with your life. It's all pleasure and pain. See, the real part of it, yes, people get, I'm sure there's all kinds of things to raise about gay marriages and so on and so forth. But the fundamental point is how do they make this work? How come 30 years ago this wouldn't have passed? 40 years ago it wouldn't have come close. 50 years ago you wouldn't even have raised the issue. And they said, well, that's because everybody was homophobic. No, it's because, in fact, they've spent years, decades. This is part of what Russell was involved in. Okay, and he wasn't even that he liked homosexuals. He just wanted the idea of sexual freedom, pleasure and pain being the defining character of human nature. Then what's your argument? How can you argue? You know, what's your philosophical? You say human beings are animals. It's all pleasure and pain. Okay. Now I can show you something. Monkeys engage in homosexual activity. Okay. You think it's nature that says we should have children and be heterosexual? No. All kinds of animals are a little squishy, okay? And they, why? Because they get a certain amount of pleasure out of it. Now, if you have a human being, what's his human right? His human right is to have the pleasures as long as it doesn't harm somebody else. So if you have two consenting adults, they both get pleasure out of it. What is a heterosexual marriage about? It's about children? No, there's no pleasure in children. That's pain. So, you know, you have to,
that is so bad.
Okay.
The point is the population also.
Yeah, of course. Yes. And then it becomes the fact that you're producing, because children, the future. What's the whole point of children? It's the future. You're contributing something to the future. You don't know how it's going to turn out, but it's a human being. It has creative potential, and that human being is going to be part of the future. And they're telling you, forget the future. It's all how you feel. It's all pleasure and pain. And so we saw that, look, the most extreme, once you went past the following form, that was, I think that was a bit of a threshold. AIDS. Here you had a disease. A disease.
Right.
Okay. We were accused of being fascists for suggesting testing and so on and so forth. Okay, we were called every, and what was the argument of the homosexual, the gay lobby? Okay, it was, we have a right, my disease has a right to spread because it's part of my pleasure. In order for me to have pleasure, I have to have the right to engage in this kind of sexual activity as I please. I mean, I have to have a consenting adult. Now, once you said that a disease has a civil right, in order to carry out sexual activity, what else, where else do you go after that?
What is medical law?
What are you going to say? Now, I tell you, one of the great ironies I did see in this, even though it's still a contention, is some members of what you might call the gay community or whatever, at a certain point, were less hostile, a certain small percentage, maybe 10%, but not an insignificant percentage. Why? Because they realized that their friends were dead. Their best friends were dead. A lot of them. Tens of thousands. I met gay people who said, look, I don't have a friend left in the world. I'm the only one left. And so some of them had enough sense to say, you know, maybe you were right. Maybe you're not a bunch of, you know, concentration camp guards or something. So that's what you have to stick by the truth. And then you may even win friends of the most unusual sorts. But that's what they've done. And yes, they don't want to reproduce people.
To understand that there's a huge difference between anti-gay culture and anti-gay. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I completely support the anti-gay culture. I do think that, you know, it's a completely degenerate culture. They're trying to, you know, like you said, they're trying to end the future. But there's a difference between saying, you know, oh, all gay people are bad because, you know,
yeah.
I've looked at both extremes. Extremes are bad, but. No,
I have no, look, it's, you know, there's also, you know, sometimes you don't like the sin, but you love the sinner.
Yeah.
Okay.